Well, thank you, Dima, for this nice and kind introduction. You know, you said already I've been working, among other things, but actually quite intensely in decision making under uncertainty. And over the last 20 years, over the past 20 years, and for the last probably 3-4 years, Adam Dominiak and I have started to work on this strategic ambiguity in game theme again. I've done some work on this strategic ambiguity in games in the early 2000s, sometimes with David Kelsey and a few other co-authors, but this paper, which I'm going to present directly after Easter in the third session, is joint work with Adam Dominiak. So I should say that right at the beginning, in the third session, I have a title slide, you know, which keeps him, where you have his name visible and you see a bit more of him. Now, the research was motivated by the fact that game theory is pretty much, in a theoretical sense, still at the times of Nash, you know, that means of the early 50s. In strategic games, little has changed, you know, in the way we think about games and we analyze games. On the other hand, experimental game theory has shown that the prediction of Nash equilibrium is not always a good prediction. Sometimes it is okay, sometimes it is not. And there's a, I think, a quite nice paper in the American Economic Review in 2001 or two, I forgot exactly, called the temporary. Sorry, Dima.
2001. Just one. Two.
Okay. The 10 treasures of game theory, exactly by Charlie Holt, an experimentalist, and the 10 treasures actually mean he has 10 examples where Nash equilibrium works well, and he has 10 examples where it doesn't work at all, you know. So it basically raises already the issue to what extent Nash equilibrium is a good or a bad description of actual behavior, or can be a good or bad description of actual behavior. That was a starting point. And of course, as you may imagine, after 20 years of field now to have a look at the game or broader context, in particular context which takes into account developments in decision theory, which were not around when Nash was writing it, and which were not even around when I started to work in the field of decision and uncertainty. And in this context, you know, we introduce with the intention to talk about the strategic environment, about context of games. In this approach, we use an idea which came up early by Thomas Schelling, a famous game theorist of the early hours of 1959 in his Strategy of Conflict. He made a couple of comments about how we should view games and look at games for applying them. But at the time, of course, he didn't do any technical analysis. You know, so this is basically a collection of very good examples, descriptive examples about how and when Nash equilibrium may work as well. So it's not experimental, but it's a complement to what experimental theory does, experimental work does now. Anyway, so when we set up, Adam Dominiak and I, to work on this new concept of games, we suggest a new equilibrium, which is related to Nash equilibrium, but cannot be the same as Nash equilibrium, because we have a different notion of beliefs beliefs of about the opponent's play and about the equilibrium, what it means to be in equilibrium. Now, I'll talk about that in a lot of detail 3 weeks from now, 2 weeks from now. So I don't want to go in depth here. And as Dima mentioned already, the paper has been accepted for games and economic behavior. And as it uses this paper, a lot of decision theoretic new stuff. I just mentioned a few things like capacities, Choquet expected utility, multiple priors, core of a capacity, alpha MEU, JP capacities, etc. You have to be a specialist to have heard about all of these things, that's quite clear. And even, I should mention that, one referee of Games and Economic Behavior suggested we should add an online appendix explaining in a kind of survey most of these concepts. And that's actually what we did. So when the paper will be out, you'll get this appendix too. But on the other hand, I've been presenting the paper in different stages over the last 3 or 4 years, and I usually found we get stuck very early on in some discussion about these underlying concepts. And therefore, I'm quite grateful for Dima to making this room, and of course for the audience to be willing to bear with me for 3 sessions in a row. Because I want to use the first 2 today and next week to introduce exactly in some of the background in decision theory, which we will use then in the final presentation of the paper, and which may allow me in the presentation after Easter to be much quicker with these concepts, because I don't have to introduce them again. So that's the idea. So we will today and in the next session talk about some of the underlying concepts in decision theory, and then turn directly to the paper and focus in the paper, that's my idea, focus on the notion of equilibrium and what consistency of belief means. That's an important issue, because consistency in Nash equilibrium means every player does the best he can do given what the other players do, or expecting that the other players behave in their optimal way as well. And this is not possible if you move away from the traditional belief concept which Nash equilibrium uses, which is essentially a probability distribution. And so what I want to do, now I hope I can get the thing moving. A quick overview. After this introduction, you know, I turn to risk and expected utility and say a few words, probably 5-6 slides. That's a point where I think, you know, you're probably all familiar with, you know, this is a kind of things you use in economic analysis of decision making in the context of financial markets, contracts, etc. So I think this is a starting point where we take off from. And then I will talk about the different objects of choice, you know, that's for today, and how you can basically extend expected utility theory to these kind of areas. And that involves mainly von Neumann-Morgenstern, Savage, and Anscombe-Aumann. And I want to conclude today with some of the famous experimental work by Allain and Ellsberg about problems coming up in experimental work consistently with these decision concepts introduced so far. And next week, we'll talk about 4 and 5. That means CEU, MEU, and related stuff. And in particular in this context, because this will be important for the work we're doing in the game theory application, we'll talk about optimism and pessimism, or alpha MEU in this setup. Now, part 2 is exactly what I want to do in the week after Easter in April. That's the paper. That's mainly the paper, you know, I've written with Adam, and which will be published in games. So I don't want to discuss it now in any depth, you know. You see some things come up here, which we'll talk about next week, Jaffre capacities, belief functions, etc. So when we come to the main presentation of the paper where we need these concepts, I hope you're already a little bit used to them and familiar with them. So it will be easier to focus on the game theoretic. Now, let me say a word to the slides I'm using. Of course, for the session today and the session next week, I use slides from a mini course which I gave in Paris at the end of 2019 in December. And at the time, I had about 6 hours to present or introduce into the subjects. So I was thinking about what I could do to give similar kind of information to you in about 2 hours. You know, I understand I have 1 hour till noon today, and about the same time, I should get on perm time, 3 to 4 next week. Anyway, so what I will do, I will skip some of the slides. You know, that means I will not spend much time sometimes explaining the definition, even reading them out to you, because some of them are only a step in what I want to explain. So I will go very quickly through some of the slides and spend more on others. But I decided not to take them out, you know, because at least you see what's there. And I could say, of course, a lot more on some of these other slides as well. And maybe one or the other who's interested and really gets into reading one or the other of this stuff and takes note of that may simply want to contact me or send me an email or raise issues later on. So that's my offer, so to speak, to make it more accessible. Okay, now let's get into the matter. Yeah. I skip the literature, you know, and will not talk about it in detail. Now, just in decision theory, we usually distinguish two approaches according to what's the object of choice. In the von Neumann-Morgenstern theory, the objective choice is a probability distribution over outcomes, simple or called a lottery. That's what we mean by a lottery. That's essentially driven by the fact that von Neumann-Morgenstern were thinking about randomizations as mixed strategies, something a decision maker chooses deliberately. And that these mixed strategies become a belief, you know, is something which came later in decision theory. And the second type of objects are the so-called state-conditioned outcomes. This is probably the approach, or this is kind of thing which is most common in economics. You use that in financial economics. If you talk about, returns to an investment of a portfolio, etc. Now, in both cases, for both types of objects, you know, the idea is that we start from preferences and derive representations, and the older literature, which I mean up to 1960, et cetera, always just deduced expected utility as a kind of representation, which was considered to be the most appropriate to analyze decisions over these kind of objects. Now, there's one difference which I would raise immediately because it will come up a couple of times. In the case of lotteries, you have the probability distribution given. So probabilities are not an issue. So if you want to have an expected utility, probabilities are simply part of the exogenous thing you're starting with. In state-conditioned outcomes, as we do it in economics, there are no probabilities of states in general. And that means the theory has to provide as well, or derive as well, probabilities over states and therefore, in consequence, over outcomes. This is the main difference. So we have a preference order over lotteries and state conditioned outcomes. And according to this distinction, we usually talk about decisions under risks. If there's a probability distribution as part of the information, the outside information for expected utility, as in lotteries, as in draws from urns and gambles, etc. And we talk about decision under uncertainty if probabilities of outcomes are not part of the information. So where should they come from? Savage was a really, seminal theorist who wanted, or who did actually derive it from actual observed behavior. So subjective probabilities are probabilities which you can infer from the behavior of people. Here you have the same list once again, as I said, for Neumann-Morgenstern, treat expected utility for choice of lotteries, and Savage, subjective expected utility. Here you see already the shorthand for that as it comes to choice over actions or state condition outcomes. I want to mention a third important paper in this context. And this is a paper I know from many presentations, which is not so well known outside decision theory. That means in application, it's usually not mentioned at all. Ernst Kempe-Naumann in 1962, used both subjective and objective probability distribution in their theory, because they looked at state-conditioned, not outcomes, but state-conditioned lotteries over outcomes. This is an extension which one may think, you know, what it is good for. You'll see later on, this makes life a lot easier in some cases, but it's not without constraints if you want to apply that stuff. So let's get into it. As I said, 4 or 5 slides to just connect to what I think you know of. Consider a finite set of outcomes. Then the set of probabilities over outcomes is simply the simplex of the same dimension. So if you have n outcomes, these could be vectors or anything, but you have n finite number of outcomes. Then you have n probabilities for these outcomes. And that means all probability distributions you could have over x are the probability distributions in this simplex delta n. And the starting hypothesis of von Neumann-Morgenstern and many others is that there is a preference order on these lotteries in the set. And of course, the idea is that representations like expected utility, we can never observe. That's quite clear. What we can observe is behavior of people. We know whether they buy a portfolio A or a portfolio B. We can see what they do, but not what they actually, how they evaluate or whether they use expected utility as a kind of value function. Now, the basic idea actually is not even connected to decision and uncertainty. There's a very general theorem by De Broglie in 1952, which basically states, take any preference order on, now I say delta n, but in De Broglie's context, it was on any topological vector space, you know, and this is comprised, of course, simply says, take any of these, take such a space, a very, very general space, assume that there is completeness of preference. I don't want to introduce that at this stage, transitivity and continuity in some sense. And then you know there exists a function V, which gives a value to every probability distribution. So we know it represents in the following sense, the probability P is better than the probability Q if the value of P according to this function is larger than the value of Q. That's the idea of a representation. And that's already in De Broglie and it's quite old. And let me say, assumption A1, A2, and A3 are very weak because if you want to have a preference order, you have to have, or you want to have analyzed decisions, you have want to have, or you need to have completeness and transitivity, otherwise you get cycle and problems. And continuity is the only restriction that means if you look at sequences of objects, etc., in some sense, in some topology, it should converge. And that means in particularly indifference curves, if you draw pictures in economics, indifference curves must separate the sets of better points from worse points. Now, this is of course not enough for decision making under uncertainty. We would not be happy with it because no one tells us that we should be expected utility. We could be any function. You could take squares of probabilities or any other kind of arithmetic function. What we really would like to have is of course expected utility. So most of decision theory under uncertainty now looks for conditions which guarantee that this special form is our representation. And that's what we call expected utility. That means it values, of course, a probability distribution, but it values it in a very specific way, namely by given probabilities to the different outcomes and multiplying them with the utility of the outcome and then summing up and forming an average. That's where the expected value comes from. Now, without any theory or without going into any axiomatics, we see or one sees immediately that such a function has very special properties. For example, it is unique only up to a linear affine transformation. That means if I make a positive number B and multiply U of X with B, I get another utility function, which is indistinguishable. And this is because the von Neumann-Morgenstern utility function can be redefined in this way. And you see this ratio. So if you multiply U of X with K and U of X lower star with K, and U upper star with K and U lower star with K, the K simply drops out. And of course, if you add a number, it would be the same thing, it just subtracts. This is actually the reason why one can normalize usually the utility function such that the best outcome gets a value of one and the worst gets an outcome of zero. That's what von Neumann-Morgenstern does in the practical application. And maybe you have seen this diagram in a case where you have just three outcomes. You can take a triangular representation of the simplex, which I take here. So you have the probability of outcome one, probability of outcome two in these directions, and probability of outcome three goes in this direction towards the origin. Because if P1 is equal to zero and P2 is equal to zero, P3 is equal to one, necessarily. And the second thing is we know already, we've seen it on the previous page, these indifference curves, if I draw the lines in here, basically are ratios of U of X1 minus U of X3, U of X2 minus U of X3. And so these are straight lines with a slope equal to this expression. That's what I've put in here. And you see already risk aversion matters, because the difference between the utility of X1 and the utility of X3 and the utility of X2 and X3, etc., determines the slope. So risk aversion is reflected in different slopes of these indifference curves. Expected utility in this triangular representation has always linear indifference curves and parallel indifference curves, I should say. But the slope depends on risk attitudes. This is an important point, and that's why I spent a minute on it, because later on this helps me to illustrate some of the differences we'll have, you know, when we talk about non-expected utility approaches. Oops. Now, a lottery is usually the special case of such a simplex. That means we have two outcomes, one with probability pi and one minus pi, and we talk about a risk averse decision maker, as you probably, if you've done any finance, know already. If the guy is, or the guy is willing to pay a positive risk premium, and if he has a certainty equivalent QL, a willingness to pay QL, which is less than the expected value. That's our notion of risk aversion, which we can use in the context of expected utility. And I should say, this is one of the great attractions of this approach, and that's why people are reluctant, and rightly so, to give up expected utility. Because then you give up this simple separation of risk aversion and risk-loving risk neutrality. And this is, of course, very useful, as you probably know, for economic applications. And we can only distinguish it in this way due to the fact that we have expected utility. So for expected utility representation, you know, risk-averse, risk-neutral, risk-loving corresponds to the curvature view, concave, linear, convex, the risk premium being positive, null, or negative. And again, risk averse is the utility of the average value of outcomes is larger than the expected utility of these outcomes. That's risk aversion. And that means you have a certainty equivalent or a willingness to pay, which is less than the expected value. And I think this is all I wanted to say on these matters. Now, one final word on von Neumann-Morgenstern's axiomatics. Now, the thing what von Neumann-Morgenstern in their book, in their representation and axiomatic treatment really did is they noted that expected utility needs only one more assumption or axiom. You remember de Broglie had as axioms A1, A2, and A3. This is completeness, transitivity, and continuity. I just keep them. It will not be possible to go without them. But just adding one axiom A4, yeah, then you get a representation in the following sense. You will find the utility function, von Neumann-Morgenstern utility function, from the outcomes and the real numbers, such that every probability distribution is simply evaluated by the expected utility with respect to this U and the probabilities. And this is, of course, something quite surprising and worth noting, I think. It's only one simple independence axiom. And I skipped that, or I jumped across it deliberately to whet your appetite. So what is this axiom, basically? It's a really one, an important one, which we will use in different contexts. So this simply says, if you have three lotteries and you can combine them in a convex combination or in a alpha one minus alpha weighting. So I take alpha times one probability distribution plus one minus alpha times second one, and alpha of the second probability distribution plus one minus alpha times R. It is clear these convex combinations are probability distributions as well. Just do it pointwise, because the probability is a vector in this case. So you have two new vectors. And now what the axiom requires, and that is not trivial, is of course, how do you evaluate such a combined or compound lottery? You evaluate it only according to the part which is different. So whenever you have a lottery which you can split up in a compound lottery, such that there is a similar part, R, one minus alpha R, on both sides, then you can basically split them up and you say, all you're doing is evaluate this combined lottery, no matter what the lottery R is, according to P and Q. So if you find P better than Q, you must find this convex combination better than of P and R better than the convex combination of Q and R. Simply because you can separate, that's the independence, you can separate parts which are common in both setups. And this is something we come back to when we talk about Choquet and multiple prior next week. But before I do that, let me quickly remind you that, of course, the scenario I've used here to give you von Neumann-Morgenstern's representation theorem is fairly limited, because probability distributions which have a common support, which have, so to speak, the same number of fixed outcomes, are particularly rare. That's a special case, of course, but a very special one. So, of course, von Neumann-Morgenstern extended it, and in extending it to general probability distributions, so now we could consider a set of outcomes with an algebra of events. I don't want to go into details. And you have a probability distribution defined in the usual way, instead from well known from statistics. Now, this is, of course, not on a finite set X, but on an arbitrary one and with an associated algebra. Then, of course, this is then this is basically our notion of a general probability. And in order to get a similar kind of representation, and here I want to skip things for time restriction, so we need the Archimedean axiom. That means we need a different notion of continuity, but this is just the appropriate one for this context. And then we get a proposition which now says, if there are preference order over simple probability distributions, we replace by A3 stars. That means the topological de Broglie version of continuity with a version of continuity called Archimedean axiom. Again, we get the representation, but we can now write the sum over all the x which have positive weight, p of x times u of x, and we can't simply number them because there's not a finite number of outcomes. And one can even extend that beyond to the situation where you have functions, continuous functions, as probability distributions. And all you need is some minimal dominance axiom, which I do not want to mention here. Just as a footnote, we know the von Neumann-Morgenstern function must be bounded in this case. This follows already from one application where we can apply that to the so-called Daniel Bernoulli's St. Petersburg paradoxon in the 18th century. He already mentioned a problem, you know, with these infinite sequences or infinite probability distribution. To be precise, probability distributions over infinite sets. Okay, now let me quickly come to Savage. And hope to stay in my context. As I said, in the Savage context, we have no probability distributions. We have now states of the world, and we have consequences, and we call acts mappings from states of the world into consequences. That's exactly what we do in economics if we have state-dependent wealth levels or state-dependent outcomes in a insurance kind of problem, etc. And we call throughout events subsets E of S. And here is an example. If you have just two states and just three outcomes, could be anything you like, you know, monetary values or non-monetary values, candidates of an election, etc. That could be all kind of things. Then, of course, you can write down all functions, all acts which one could have, and there are exactly 9 of them. That means it's exactly 3 to the power of 2, you know. So if you have finite sets, then you always can list them in a table, and you would have state continuum. That means if you place the act F3 and state 1 comes up, then you get A, and if you play F3 and state 2 comes up, you get C. And you know that's always well defined for every act. You know what the outcome is in the two states. The second example, which is very often used in this context, are so-called bets on an urn. And we get this to see many of these bets now in the next sections. So if you have an urn, say with black and white balls, and the ball will be drawn randomly, or in a way that you can't see it, then you can, of course, define acts as a bet on white, which says if you choose a bet on white, you win if the ball which is a ball which has been drawn is white, and if you bet on white and the ball which is drawn is black, you get nothing. And for black, it's just the opposite. You know, you win if a black ball is drawn and you get nothing for zero. And you see, you can translate that easily into states, black and white, consequences, one and two, zero and one, and acts are simply all the mappings we can have in this situation, which is a previous table, actually, if you would substitute for A and B. Now, in financial economics, etc., we very often, and I guess it's something you've seen in economics quite often, if, say, we have a wealth levels as outcome, and we have different states. In insurance cases, you very often have a state where a damage occurs and a state where no damage occurs. You may have, in financial economics, may have a state, you know, where the business cycle is at its peak, or a business cycle is at the trough, so you may have two states. And then you can draw them in a diagram where basically you have all the possible wealth level outcomes in state one, and all the wealth outcomes in state two on the vertical axis, then every point in this diagram is basically an act. And of course, you have infinitely many of these acts here, and you usually have indifference curves to distinguish and choose between them. Now, in Savage's approach, which I don't want to, I don't have the time to go through in details. We basically now derive a scenario, a setup, and I don't go into the formulas here, where we need seven axioms or seven premises in order to derive expected utility. But note, we will derive expected utility and the probability distribution at the same time, all from preferences over these kind of acts. So I skip these very quickly because I just needed notation in order to explain the axioms. And you see we have an axiom weak order, which is basically the same as A1 and A2, completeness and transitivity. And I use the wording or names from Savage in his book. And we have the sure thing principle, which is our independence axiom or the equivalent in the state contingent setup. And you would need the notation I indicated on the previous page to really explain that in detail. I don't want to do that here. And you need something called state independence as an axiom. You need something which is called outcome independence. And you need that as non-trivial choice. That means you have to have at least two acts, where one is strictly better than the other. Now, just as a remark, P3 implies that the von Neumann-Morgenstern utility is state independent. P4 implies that the probabilities do not depend on the outcomes. And P3 and P5 imply that the state space does not have probability zero. And then you need two technical assumptions, dominance assumption and state partition. And I'm jumping through to the result. This is the result. Savage, 1954, in his Foundations of Statistics, a very important book and a book worthwhile having a look into at some stage. It's nearly not just mathematics. It's a lot of conceptual issues discussed in detail. Now, what he says is, suppose you have a preference order over acts. The script F is a set of all those functions from states to consequences. If you have a preference order and say satisfy these axioms, P1, P2, P3, P5, P6, P7, then, and this is a new thing, then you have first the probability measure, a finitely additive, non-additive probability measure on the states. And you have a bounded, unique, up to this affine transformation, which von Neumann-Morgenstern had already before, utility function such that F is preferred to G exactly if the expected utility of F is preferred to the expected utility of G. And note, we can't write a sum anymore in general, because these acts are, of course, now on state spaces, which are not simply finite, where you can just distance. Basically, the new thing is, and this is really a contribution of Savage, that you have this probability measure derived from preferences. And I can't go into that at this stage. So that's an interesting side issue. So let me come to the end of this axiomatic part, because I need a little bit of time to explain some of the of the counterexamples, which I promised you for the end of this talk, which will be the starting point for our discussion of Choquet next week. So notice Savage in 1954 allows for arbitrary states and arbitrary outcomes. These sets S and X don't have to have any structure. They could be vector spaces of real numbers as we do it in finance. They could be outcomes like candidates in an election and they are finite. They could be really everything, the X outcome. And even states could be finite or infinite. There's no constraint. And in this case, one needs many axioms. You remember P1 to P7, and P1 you could even split up in completeness and transitivities, and you would have 8 axioms in order to get this characterization. That means we need many assumptions to tie down, to pin down a probability distribution. And about 10 years later, in 1964, Anscombe and Aumann published a very small paper, you know, in I think Econometrica, but I'm not quite sure. But it's a very small one. It's only 5-6 pages long, which proves the same thing which Savage proved in his book in a full chapter in many, many pages in a very short way. And the reason why Anscombe-Aumann could get it was that they looked at what they called mappings or acts which map from states into probability distributions over acts. So you have an outcome space, X, and P of S are probability distributions over X, which are finitely supported. So the object where you map to is no longer X directly, but probability distributions or lotteries over X, one could say. Now, at the first hand, one would think this makes it much more complicated, but quite to the contrary, it makes life a lot easier. Why is that? Because a set of probability distributions has a nice structure. You can form convex combinations, you can do lots of mathematical things which you can't do on a general outcome set and on a general state space. So Anscombe and Aumann only need 5 axioms, and this includes already A1 and A2 as we know it. So they separate them. They need only 3 more axioms in order to get a nice representation of the expected utility type. And this is mainly because they can take any 2 probability distribution and form a convex combination and have again a probability distribution. This is a trick which works and helps them a lot. And of course, one can define these axioms in some detail, and this is not without interest, but let me remark at this stage, Anscombe-Aumann just thought what they do is a simplification of Savage. Why? Because if you use these lotteries, simple lotteries always contains the lotteries which give probability 1 to a single outcome. So the so-called Dirac measures, this means the probability distributions which give probability 1 to a single A and 0 otherwise, these probability distributions are always included in PS, no matter what other restriction you put on. And therefore, you would always have as a special case, the Savage acts. But of course, you have many, many more. And so if you read the paper, Anscombe-Aumann just sells her paper in 1964 as a simplification of Savage. But as a matter of fact, and I would not present it if it was just that, when we come to Choquet expected utility and multiple prior, all the literature works only in the Anscombe-Aumann context. It's not immaterial because you can take these probability distributions over outcomes, which Anscombe-Aumann take as objective probability distributions. Yeah? That means you look at the situation. Textbook by, I think David Krebs, I think introduced it. He calls it horse race lotteries. It's something like you have a horse race, you want to bet on a horse, whether it wins or not in a race. And of course you don't know what the state is about, whether the horse wins or not. But you will not get a prize in money, but you get a prize in terms of a lottery ticket. But the lottery ticket is well defined. That means it gives you a fixed known outside probability a certain outcome. And this kind of distinctions that these are objective probabilities, while the probabilities we derive in the theory on S are subject probabilities, is exploited by Choquet and by Schmeidler, as we later see in the Choquet expected utility. That's why I introduce it here and mention it here. I don't want to go into details, examples, mixtures. You have the axioms. Actually, the axioms are quite easy and much more intuitive. And you get the result, which, not surprising, you have a preference order now over these H acts. This is just a set of all mappings from states into simple lotteries or into finitely supported lotteries, which satisfy axioms A1, A2, A3, and A4, A5, and A6, six axioms. And these axioms can be easily stated because we can form convex combinations of A1 and A2. So Anscombe-Aumann use again independence as an axiom rather than sure thing principle, which was something Savage had to invent because he couldn't form convex combinations over outcomes in a general outcome space. Okay, and you get, of course, not surprisingly, a unique affine transformation for Neumann-Morgenstern utility U. And you get a unique probability distribution pi on S. And notice this pi is a subjective probability on the states because it's not known what the probability on S is. But of course, you have probabilities on outcomes. And these probabilities are, of course, the HS, that means the lottery which you get in state S and which gives a weight to X. And this is the expected utility in state S if you go over the lottery HS. And pi of S is now the probability which is subjective, and you can combine the two. And when we talk about Choquet, one will have to notice, because when we talk about ambiguity aversion and optimism and pessimism, this is an important distinction. It is not in Anscombe-Aumann itself as they originally supposed or proposed it. Now, I think I probably have some 10 minutes left or so. I want to give you 2 or 3 minutes. Is that okay, Dima? 10 minutes is okay?
Yeah, you have about...
I know, I wanted to leave 5 minutes if possible for questions, but I can take 15 minutes anytime. Yeah.
Do the 10 and then do the questions.
Okay. What I wanted to do for concluding today is make it a little bit more interesting, maybe, in providing these paradoxa, which are on the one hand well known, but I find very often people have, when I presented it somewhere else, in Paris or anywhere, I'm not claiming, but many people have just a vague idea. And so let's talk about it. There's the Allais paradox and the Ellsberg paradox I will be talking about. And there are many more in Kahneman Tversky's econometrica paper on prospect theory. I can't go into details, but they take up on Allais and develop it with many more examples. And these experiments I will present, and just to want to remark that Allais and Ellsberg has been running lab experiments over and over again. There are surveys who look into it and say the important thing is they represent something which I would call a robust deviation from expected utility. That means it's not the simple thing, it's something which is robust. And I want to explain that to you. Maybe you have seen it, it won't take too long, but Allais was the first one immediately after von Neumann-Morgenstern. He came up with this example to demonstrate or to argue that expected utility is not a good representation. And of course, von Neumann-Morgenstern was on objective probabilities. So it's in the context of lotteries, not of state contingent outcomes. In Ellsberg, we go to the state contingent outcomes. So what you see is a lottery which has, we have lotteries which could have three outcomes. 1 million, I learned if I read, if you read the articles, these are old French francs, you know, before they were, so at the time that was probably something like 10 new francs or so later on. 5 million, you know, or zero. These are the three outcomes. And all lotteries are on these outcomes. So you have first lottery A gives you with 10% with 100% probability, because if you add them up, it's 100, 1 million. So you get 1 million for sure. Lottery B is you get 5 million with 10%, and you get with 10%, and you get 1 million with 89%, sorry, and you get zero with 1%. So you, if the first one is a certain 1 million, now you have 10% chance of getting 5 million, you have a 1% chance of getting nothing, and otherwise you get a 1 million. Now, people were asked to choose between A and B. And let me state, most people found A better than B. Yeah, that's simply observation. And you can ask yourself whether you would have chosen it the same way, but that's what you find in the literature. That's what Allah represents and what lots of empirical literature tells us to. And after they made this choice, he offered them two other lotteries, C and D. And he offered the lottery 1 million with 10%, 1 million with 1%. So you had basically 11%, 1 million, and 89% nothing. And the last lottery, D, was 5 million with 10% and zero otherwise. And you could ask people how they felt about and how they think about. And the most, what most people observed is basically that D is preferred to C. So they preferred now 5 million, 10% chance on 5 million versus nothing over 1 million with 11% and nothing otherwise. And I think there is some intuition. I don't want to discuss it. You can form your opinion. And if you've seen it, you may have already an opinion. So what I report here is basically what Alain reports as typical. He asked a couple of people, you know, the typical rankings he found. And now the interesting thing is, and that's actually why the axiomatic method is so interesting. We can't say a word about expected utility just looking at that, but we can, of course, use the independence axiom to immediately say this is impossible with expected utilities. Okay, that's not possible with expected utility. And the reason is, if I had time enough, I would give you the example. It's usually in my program. You can show that basically there's a lottery such that A, lottery A is just lottery C, convex combination of lottery C and this lottery, call it E, etc. And you get lottery B as a convex combination of D and E with the same weight. And therefore, of course, you know, according to the independence axiom, A should be A versus B should be ranked the same way as C over D versus D. So you can have A over B, that's perfectly okay, but then by independence you must C over D. Or you can have B over A, that's perfectly okay, then you must D over C. What you cannot have is A over B and then D over C. That's not possible with expected utility. And actually the easiest way to do it, write out the expected utility of these terms and it's not hard to see. Now, what does it mean? You see the lotteries, if I draw them in this diagram, so you have probability of 1 million on the horizontal, probability of 5 on the vertical axis, and probability of 0 down here. Then of course, every point in this triangle that we've seen before is a lottery. And if I now put down the lotteries A, B, C, and D in this setup, then you see C lies down here. You can check that easily at home in a minute. And lottery D lies here. Lottery B, A lies here. In the with certainty, you get 1 million. And B lies somewhere below the 45 degree lines at the top. But in particular, the line joining A and B is parallel to the line joining D and C. And that means, of course, if you now have linear indifference curves, when parallel indifference curves, as you have in expected utility all the time, then you can have either this situation that's now steeper than this. In this case, C would be better than D, and A would be better than B. Yeah? Because the parallel lines, of course, can write this, cut this only in this, and in this way, you have increasing utility. So this is a behavior, you know, you would find in A. What you could have as well that the indifference curves are flatter. That's possibly a bit harder to draw than the lines AB. Then you would prefer D over C and B over A. But what you cannot have with parallel lines is that you have C over D and then B over A. That's just not possible. And the consequence, just the remarks that we have, don't have time to go into it. The consequence is prospect theory then argues about certainty effects and impossibility effects, which simply means at least as you get close to situations of probability one and zero, these indifference curves are no longer linear, but somehow distorted. And we come to that later. So this is choice over lotteries. Now let's look at, that's a story about rank dependent utility theory. I don't want to spend a lot of time on that. Here we get to the Ellsberg paradox. And that's my final thing. And I just want to take the two earned, the one earned kind of example. Ellsberg paradox in his famous article 1962, which comes from his PhD thesis, written under Howard Reifer, provides you with the following kind of example and decision situation. And again, just to make this point, here we have now state conditions outcome. I explain that in a moment. It's no probabilities given. You have state conditions outcomes. So this is a contradiction to Savage. So you can show using the axioms of Savage, in particular his sure thing principle, that you cannot have what we observe in the experiment. And so you see the axioms are exactly the key instrument to make such distinctions. Let me quickly explain. Suppose you have an urn, and the urn has red balls, blue balls, and yellow balls. And the experimenter tells you there are 30 red balls out of 90. And 60 balls are either blue or yellow. Yeah. So that's basically the situation. And now you can have the lottery or bet A. You win 100 if a red ball will be drawn from the urn. And lottery B is you win 100 if a blue ball is drawn from the urn. And you compare and you can ask, and I simply ask you, you know, what lottery do you prefer? And that's what Ellsberg does. And let me record, most people choose lottery A over lottery B. They prefer to bet on red over blue. Now you offer them a second lottery, a pair of lotteries, lottery C and lottery D. Now lottery C wins on red if a red ball is drawn or a yellow ball is drawn. So it wins on two outcomes, red or yellow. And lottery D wins on blue and yellow. So that means if blue or yellow is drawn, you win here 100. Otherwise you get zero. Now you're again free to choose, but most subjects chose in this case D over C. And again, this is a contradiction to expected utility, or actually not to expected utility, I should say to the existence of a probability distribution. You could of course have, you could of course prefer A over B, but then you have to choose C over D. And the sure thing principle basically said, you know, you can divide off, you know, what is the common thing on two lotteries. And you see the outcome on Y is zero in the first two lotteries, and the outcome is 100 on C and D in the second two lotteries. And because the sure thing principle says you have to rank these lotteries without the common part, you know. Therefore, if you rank R over B, you have to rank C over D. Because the common part is 100, and it has to be sure thing principle independent of that. Now, most subjects reveal these preferences. And of course, this is not compatible with the probability distribution. And actually, in this experiment, you see already the idea which Savage uses to extract probabilities from preferences. Because given these two lotteries, which have the same outcomes, 100 and zero, so if you prefer A over B, the only reason one could sensibly give is that you think the probability of a red ball is higher than the probability of a blue ball. And if you prefer over C over D, because the outcomes are the same, you must assume that the probability of red and yellow, or red or yellow, should be larger than the probability of blue or yellow. And of course, A preferred A implies probability of R is larger than the probability of B. D over C, probability of red plus probability of Y, smaller than probability of B plus probability of Y, if you decide in this way. And of course, the negative probability, you just can drop both sides, you know, and so you see you have a contradiction. The first choice reveals that you prefer, you find the likelihood of red larger than B. The second reveals that red is valued or ranked, gives a smaller probability than Y. And that's of course the Ellsberg paradox, which is in its own right important because it shows you the, if you want to derive a probability distribution from preferences, you have to make very strict and strong assumptions on the preferences which are allowed, which are reasonable to distinguish these kind of necessary conditions for probability, for a consistent probability distribution. Now, my talk ends here. Let me say one word which leads into next week. That was 1962. And in the 70s, 80s, David Schmeidler and a lot of my older colleagues, almost senior colleagues, started to work on this problem. And as a consequence, we have now published in 1989, Choquet expected utility. We have multiple prior, Gilboa-Schmeidler. We have alpha MAU by, I think it was Girardardo Marinacci, but don't hold me to it, absolutely. And so on, we have many, many representations, all representations we can, which can handle the Ellsberg paradox by basically giving us measures for beliefs, which are not as strict as probability measures. That's where the capacities come in. That's where the multiple prior comes in, etc. I'll talk about that in full length next week. That will be our topic next week. But we have to weaken that because you see, whenever this Ellsberg paradox will destroy the assumption of expected utility. So you have to weaken probabilities. There's no way around that. That's what we're going to do. But let me say that, of course, it's not just weakening. In some other sense, we have to strengthen it in the light of experimental results. So we do not just want to make our axioms weaker, but we want to weaken them in the right way and strengthen them in another way to account for the observed deviations. Okay, that's where I want to stop. That's next week's beginning.
Thank you very much, Jürgen. Thank you for this short course of decisions in uncertainty from von Neumann-Morgenstern's expected utility to close to non-additive probabilities, almost everything done within 1 hour. I hope, well, the good news is that we have over 30 people.
Dima, I left a lot of lacunas. I left a lot of lacunas and slides where I went fast, you know. I'm very, very much aware of that. And when I gave the course in Paris, I would spend probably at least an extra hour to just fill some of these lacunas. But someone in the audience has interest and wants to know more, you know, on what the question is, he will get a quick answer or he may get a reference. We can read
that. That's what I was just about to say, that maybe some people found it a little bit tough because it was a little bit quick, but I still would like to invite everyone to come to the next seminar. And maybe if there are any questions right now, I think Jürgen will be happy to take questions.
Of course.
Now, but if you think you would like to see the slides again before asking questions, maybe it would be useful if you send questions to me or directly to Jürgen before the next week's session, so that Jürgen can address the questions in the beginning of the session.
Dima, did I send you the slides? I forgot.
You haven't yet, but once you send them, I can distribute them.
I can. But I send you the paper, I presume, if I remember
it
so long.
You send me the paper, and we will distribute the paper.
Okay.
From my experience, I think that it is really useful to familiarize yourself with it, familiarize with the notation, because once it comes to the paper, it will make it much, much, much easier to understand what's in the paper. Because Jürgen tends to follow exactly the same notation everywhere. I'm pretty sure I
do my best. It's not perfect, but I do my best.
Let us ask if there are any questions, because otherwise I will be always. Yes, there is a question in the. Yes, there will be the paper.
No, it's not the question. For me, it was a little bit. too complicated, to be honest, because I'm not absolutely a prof in game theory, and I need to look through the slides in order to ask questions and in order to understand.
Yes, we will.
If you send us the paper in order to be more prepared, it will be great.
I will send the paper and I will send the slides that the Jürgen has presented so that it makes it a little bit easier, because the slides are a very good reference point for the theory. Jürgen?
Maria, I completely agree. You know, I think it's just a complex field, you know, and I've worked in this field now for 25 years. I started in 1994, etc., with courses. And of course you get into it. I'm much aware of it. But if you want to provide some access to this field, you know, the question is, how do you do that? And I thought it is better to drop some of the notation and the detailed definition. I didn't give you, so it's written on the slides, and I could even add some extra slides to explain it more, a definition for, say, the sure thing principle, etc. But sometimes one needs to introduce notation a little bit in order to just say what one wants to state. Yeah. And I wanted to leave that, what I would hope you take away from here. I can say it in three words, you know. There is a tradition in decision under uncertainty, which in the first part tried to derive conditions for expected utility. Conditions for expected utility, which you could test in an experiment. And Allain and Ellsberg immediately jumped into it. And you just look at the publication. Ellsberg is about 8 years after Savage, you know. Allain is about 5 years after von Neumann-Morgenstern. And you get exactly the challenging empirical examples. Yeah? And you could only do them, I think, you know, because of the axiomatization. But this was the first part. That was basically up to the 60s. And the second part, which I'll talk about next week, is now taking up from there. Yeah. But one has to see that the motivation of these people, and I hope that I could convey the motivation of these people to provide us with axioms for expected utility, provided at the same time the incentives for looking empirically what people actually do. Yeah. And it was clear, and that's why I said Ellsberg and Allain are so important, because they're really robust. You run any experiment you want. I've done it with colleagues. The behavior in the Ellsberg urn is always this way. Of course, as in empirical work, of course, not 100%. You know, I've just a couple of weeks ago, we've done an experimental study where some urn type example was involved. And of course, you find about, say, 60 to 70% of people consistently choose in the way Ellsberg described it. There are a few others who do other things. That's completely okay. But we know a large majority, and you can't convince them. It's not that you tell them. That's actually an interesting exchange. If you really want to read something non-technical, read the discussion of Ellsberg. Take the Ellsberg article, which is cited in my paper, and read what Reifer and the others did in the discussion. This is purely verbal, you know? And this is interesting because Reifer said, well, these people just didn't watch out and were not careful, you know? It's like not counting correctly, you know? It can happen to me. If you ask me quickly to add up 10 numbers and I make a mistake, that doesn't mean arithmetic is wrong. Yeah. But then, of course, if you observe in experimental work, you know, that people always decide in non-expected utility way, you have to respond to it. And of course, the first response was to deny that there's a problem, you know, and say, this is just the kind of mistake of these people.
I think what we get to,
that's why I think this is a more important message I want to get across. And of course, you will see part of the notation again, and this will be easier. And anyway, if you want to do the work and work through the slide, which is probably not easy either if you do it without my talk, but you're most welcome.